Welcome to Online Worship This Weekend. My name is Lindsay Beaulieu. I am the Director of Operations here at beautiful First Presbyterian Church in Morganton, North Carolina. Today's the final week of our sermon series, Reimagine Life with Jesus. Over the past few weeks, we've been studying writings from Paul, outlining some of the most practical transformations that occur in the life of a disciple. We've talked about reconciling broken relationships, redeeming our former lives, and reframing our walk with Jesus. In today's reading, we continue in the book of 1 Timothy. This is a deeply personal letter written from the Apostle Paul to his dear student and mentee, Timothy. It's part of what we call the pastoral epistles because it's written from one pastor to another with all kinds of guidance and advice. Now today we get to talk about everybody's favorite subject, money. Yay! It was one of Jesus's most heavily discussed topics, and in fact, he spoke more about money than about faith and prayer combined. I think that should tell us something. See, I grew up thinking that Jesus was this middle-class white guy who walked around in this sparkling white cloak. When I pictured Jesus teaching and preaching, I see smiling faces laughing and playing on the hillside as they picnic together and have a leisurely afternoon. I think I probably even had a Sunday school coloring page with that image. But over time, we've somehow lost the actual context of Jesus' ministry. See, at the time of Jesus' birth, the Roman government occupied the nation of Israel. And the Israelite people lived under brutal oppression from the government. Caesar required heavy taxes, and then they had to pay tithes to the temple as well. Many people earned very low wages, and so the taxes and the tithes kept them completely underwater. Often families would have to sell their eldest son into slavery in order to feed the rest of the children. It's estimated that up to a quarter of all people within Roman territories were slaves. They had no rights and were regarded as personal property bought and sold at the pleasure of their master. Now, sometimes, especially in Galilee, which was a farming society, tenant farmers would have to borrow money from their landlords, who, ironically, were often Pharisees and other religious leaders. Conditions were deplorable. Archaeological excavations from that time show that most people walked around with a number of diseases and parasites. One historical commentator I read said it's likely that most first century Israelites lived their whole life with no idea what it meant to truly feel well. And so when Jesus' ministry began, he spoke to the Israelite people, teaching and preaching to the poor and the sick and the dirty and enslaved. They were oppressed, but Jesus brought a message of hope that turned the world upside down. He said, "Blessed are the poor in spirit. Blessed are the meek. Blessed are those who hunger and thirst, those who are sad and hated and scorned." It's a message that brought hope to the Israelites at a time when life must have been incredibly difficult. So it's no wonder that money would have been one of Jesus' main teaching points because it would have been at the front of everyone's mind. Jesus felt so strongly about the plight of the poor that he said, "It is easier for a camel to go through the eye of a needle than for a rich man to get into heaven." Now this was clearly a metaphor, but the message is clear. In the kingdom of God, the poor are lifted up, the weak are made strong, and the proud are brought low. So today we fast forward to Paul's letter to Timothy, written to a completely different audience. Timothy was the pastor of a church in Ephesus, which was a major city in Asia Minor. It was made up of previously Jewish people who had converted to Christianity, and also of what we call Gentiles, which are people who were not previously Jews but have become Christians. And so in the passage we'll read, we can surmise that there were some wealthy people in the congregation. And Paul addresses that issue in his letter to Timothy. He wrote practical advice that's meant to guide Timothy and the Christians there at Ephesus. And so as we dive into the scripture for today, I think we'll find some applicable truths that can guide us as the church today. But before we get started, let's pray together. God, we come to you today and ask that you will send your Holy Spirit to be our teacher. Help us to open our hearts and our minds with humility. Help us to put aside any preconceived ideas that we might have, and help us to be open to what it is that the Scripture has for us today. We pray all these things in the mighty name of Jesus Christ. Amen. Our scripture today comes from 1 Timothy chapter 6. Hear with me the word of God. Of course, there is great gain in godliness combined with contentment. For we have brought nothing into the world so that we can take nothing out of it. But if we have food and clothing, we will be content with these. But those who want to be rich fall into temptation and are trapped by many senseless and harmful desires that plunge people into ruin and destruction. For the love of money is a root of all kinds of evil. And in their eagerness to be rich, some have wandered away from the faith and pierced themselves with many pains. But as for you, man of God, shun all this. Pursue righteousness, godliness, faith, love, endurance, gentleness. Fight the good fight of faith. Take hold of the eternal life to which you were called and for which you made the good confession in the presence of many witnesses. As for those who in the present age are rich, command them not to be haughty or to set their hopes on the uncertainty of riches, but rather on God, who richly provides us with everything for our enjoyment. They are to do good, to be rich in good works, generous and ready to share, thus storing up for themselves the treasure of a good foundation for the future, so that they may take hold of the life that really is life. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. I will never forget my first lesson when I came to work here at FPC Morganton 2 years ago. Here I was, completely green to the ministry world, and I remember John said, okay, lesson one, Presbyterians hate idolatry. Now, I remember thinking that was probably true for all Christians, but at the time, I didn't realize the level of contempt that was implied. So now, fast forward, I realize that the reason that it's such a big deal is because idolatry lies at the heart of many of the problems in our world today. We see from Scripture that it's been an issue with Christians for over 2,000 years. And in 1 Timothy chapter 6, Paul begins by offering a remedy to the idolatry that must have been plaguing the Ephesians. In verse 6, Paul says that life marked by godliness and contentment can bring us great happiness in life. Even if all we have is food and clothing, we can be content in knowing that Jesus Christ is Lord of it all. In verse 10, he goes on and we read one of the most all-time misquoted verses in history. Listen carefully. For the love of money is a root of all kinds of evil, and in their eagerness to be rich, some have wandered away from the faith and pierced themselves with many pains. Now, does this sound familiar? Over time, the words of this verse have been manipulated to sound something like, money's the root of all evil. But that's not what Paul says. He says the love of money is a root of all kinds of evil. It's an essential distinction because at the heart of the issue is a lot more than money. It's the idea of placing something above our love for Christ. That is idolatry. Paul goes on in verse 11 to urge Timothy to forge a different path. He says, but as for you, man of God, shun all of this. Pursue righteousness, godliness, faith, love, endurance, gentleness. See, these things that Paul lists are the antidotes to idolatry. When we pursue these things, we build for ourselves a different kind of wealth, an eternal treasure. Now, does that mean it's not possible to be wealthy and Christian? From hearing the context of Jesus' ministry and knowing his teachings against earthly riches, it was a question that was probably heavy on the minds of the people in Ephesus. But see, the point is not how much we have, but where our heart lies. The real question is, are we focused on the things of God? Are we focused on righteousness and godliness and contentment? Or are we focused on building wealth and status here on this earth? Paul goes on in verse 17 and says this, "As for those who in the present age are rich, command them not to be haughty or to set their hopes on the uncertainty of riches, but rather on God, who richly provides us with everything for our enjoyment. They are to be good, to be rich in good works, generous and ready to share, thus storing up for themselves the treasure of a good foundation for the future, so that may take hold of the life that really is life." In these verses, he makes it clear that any who are wealthy in this life have a huge responsibility to the community of faith. He says that they are to do good, to be rich in good works, generous and ready to share. Now, I don't know about you, but I find these words incredibly convicting. I wouldn't consider myself wealthy, and I know that there are probably people watching right now who are struggling financially. I do not want to minimize that in any way. But when we compare ourselves and our country to the first century Israelites, I think nearly all of us can probably say that we are better off in our present world. And so when I read this, I ask myself, am I rich in good works? Am I generous and ready to share? See, the possession of wealth allows for us to have generosity that can promote the good works that mark our authentic Christian life. In our first reading today, we read from the book of Jeremiah, and we see God telling the prophet to buy a piece of land, even though it seems like a complete waste. Jeremiah wouldn't have been able to make such a large purchase on the spot without some accumulation of wealth. And so God uses Jeremiah to show the Israelites that they will one day return to the promised land. All is not lost, but God is faithful through it all. Now, like in the Gospels, Paul could have told Timothy that the wealthy people in Ephesus needed to sell everything they had in order to follow Jesus. But he didn't say that. Instead, he tells them not to be haughty or to set their hopes on the uncertainty of riches, but rather on God. Instead of storing up wealth on earth, they should be generous and ready to share so that they can take hold of the life that really is life. In his book, The Politics of Jesus, Aubrey M. Hendricks writes this. He says, "The only authentic evidence of spirituality is that we have personally sought and struggled for the health, wholeness, and freedom of others." Wow. As I studied this passage over the week, I found myself wrestling with some important questions that I want to share with you. I think it's critical for those serious about following Jesus to allow space in our hearts and our minds to consider what God might be saying to us here. Number one, are you living your life with godliness and contentment? In today's culture, we are often overwhelmed by the pressure to do more, engage more, to be more. It's the American dream. As a parent, I feel like there's always one more sport, lesson, activity to schedule, so we can give everything to our kids that they want and they need. I want to do that. And yet it's impossible to be on this track of burning the candle at both ends and still experience the contentment that Paul urges. Number two, what would it look like to personally seek and struggle for the health, wholeness, and freedom of others? Did you know that in the city proper of Morganton, of all the people who live in poverty, nearly half of those are children? How would it feel to seek out those people in our community who are suffering and oppressed? Number three, what would it look like if we reimagined generosity? In your life this week, how can you live out Paul's instructions to do good, to be rich in good works, generous and ready to share? There are people right now in your life that God has placed under your direct influence that need you to be the hands and feet of Christ. How can you show radical generosity to those people? Now, I want to take a moment and address the people who are watching and thinking that they don't have anything to share. Maybe you identify more with the first century Christians we've been talking about. Maybe you're struggling emotionally, mentally, financially. Friends, you're not alone. You are here surrounded by a body of believers who wants to come alongside you and lift you up today. And so if that's you, I urge you to email me at prayer@fpcmorganton.org or call our church office and let us know how we can walk alongside you in your journey today. And so friends, today it is my prayer that you will reimagine generosity. I pray that you will seek out those in your life who desperately need the light of Christ, and may you be ready to share the message and the love of Christ with everyone you meet. Amen. If you'd like to get more plugged in with us, I would love for you to head over to our website and find the button that says Connect with Us. That will take you to an online form where you can tell us more about you and how we can serve you and your family well. You can also follow us on social media or contact our church office. We would love to meet you and walk alongside you in your faith journey. Friends, I pray for blessings on you and yours, and that you will see God working powerfully in your life this week. Amen.